Welcome to the Doha Forum. It's my great pleasure to be joined by Sheikh Mohammed bin Abdulrahman Al Thani, the Deputy Prime Minister and Foreign Minister of Qatar. Minister, the blockade of your country is now 18 months old. Is there any diplomatic progress being made?
Well, there is no progress yet happening with the blockading states. The latest thing came to our knowledge, the discussion that took place during the GCC meeting when His Highness the Emir of Kuwait has brought up the issue again to the table, asking the blockading states to come to the table and to engage in a dialogue. Unfortunately, some of the countries, they were trying to push back on these attempts. The Saudis at the end, they agreed that any suggestion will be sent to the Secretariat, but there is no breakthrough yet.
Is there any need, do you think, for Qatar to hold out an olive branch to Saudi Arabia and the other blockading states?
Well, what can be required from Qatar to make as a gesture more than Qatar was subject for this attack now for more than 18 months. Qatar was the victim. Qatar wasn't the one who attacked any of the blockading states. We had a cyber crime happened to our news agency, unfortunately, by the blockading states in order to create the entire crisis. We have our people being humiliated, being expelled from their country. We have families being separated. We have people who are prevented from going to holy places. We have people who are prevented from going to hospital. And we have people who've been, our people being prevented from food supplies, medicine, just out of the blue. So there is no gesture that Qatar can provide. The good gesture that Qatar can provide in this, that we say, despite all this, despite whatever happened, we are willing to come to the table, to sit and to discuss what are the real problems, how we can resolve these problems. And the only thing you need to understand before you come to the table, that our sovereignty is not subject for negotiation.
After the murder of Jamal Khashoggi, do you see there's any more pressure coming from the US on Saudi Arabia to resolve this crisis?
Well, first of all, the murder of Jamal Khashoggi is a barbaric crime that's condemned everywhere in the world, and we hope that the criminals who committed these crimes will be held accountable and they will be punished for the crimes, the crime they have committed. This definitely brought an international pressure on Saudi on different behaviors. One of them is Yemen, GCC, other issues in the region. But do we think that this is going to be responded by the Saudi? We are hopeful that these reparations that the Saudis need to make after this crime, that will help in stabilizing the region again. Now we see some progress in Yemen. Let us remain hopeful that this is will lead to peace in Yemen eventually. In the GCC, we didn't see any positive gesture from them, and we remain having the same position despite whatever happened.
Now, this month, Qatar, after 57 years, left OPEC, or announced it would leave OPEC, and the former Prime Minister here said it was a useless organisation that had been run essentially in the interests of Saudi Arabia. Do you concur with that thought, and is that underpinning your decision to leave
OPEC? Our decision to leave OPEC wasn't a reactionary decision. It was a decision which took a thoughtful process that we've been thinking about. And although OPEC was in different occasions politically motivated organization, but we didn't politicize this decision. We have a pure technical assessment on this decision. Simply, we are not an oil producing country. We have some production, which represents just 2% of OPEC. And we are focused more on the gas, where Qatar is the largest exporter of liquefied natural gas in the world. So we prefer to concentrate our efforts in the gas, promoting for cleaner energy, developing this industry, not in Qatar only, but around the world. And OPEC, it's more for the oil markets. And we prefer that the market drive the prices, not some organizations which sometimes might be used politically.
Now, President Trump has welcomed or urged OPEC to not to cut its production. Have they welcomed your decision to leave the organization?
Well, our decision was a surprise, of course, for a lot of OPEC members who have seen and worked with Qatar and have seen how Qatar is a reliable partner and active player in the multilateralism. But at the end, they understand the technicality behind it because they are also specialized in it.
Now, if we may move on to the Qatari Investment Authority, you chair the authority. Can you tell us what are the priorities for the QIA at the moment?
Well, Qatar Investment Authority is the sovereign wealth fund, which is to help in developing our economy, to help our diversification agenda, and to preserve the funds for the future generations. So the next generation after, post the oil, they will find that our generation has invested for them. Our strategy mainly is multi-geographical and multi-sector. So our aim is to have a diversified fund geographically and diversified in terms of asset class. Yes, we have been focused in the last years in real estate, equities, and especially in financial services. Now we are looking more at sectors like technology, healthcare, and infrastructure, where we see that we need to put more attention. Geographically, most of our investment were just focused, concentrated in Europe, and this is naturally given the maturity of the market in Europe. But also we are looking at expanding our presence in the United States. The opportunities there are very attractive for the investments. And I think that there are also plenty of opportunities in Asia where Qatar is looking at. And also we are looking at emerging and frontier regions to diversify our portfolio.
Now you had to repatriate quite a lot of money in the immediate months after the blockade. Is that still necessary to bring the liquidity back home, or have you now been able to put it back and investing abroad?
Well, at the beginning of the crisis, actually our country was under an economic warfare. And this was part of the plan. Against Qatar, part of the blockading. The plan is to undermine and to distress the economy and our currency. So the sovereign wealth fund, Qatar QIA funds, which were allocated in different investments, helped in stabilizing the financial situation here. But now, right now, our economy is doing very well. The financial reserves are doing very well in the central bank. And we are very well positioned and ready for the new investments.
You've had a long history of investing in the UK. Have you got plans for further investments at the moment?
We have our investments in the UK is around £60 billion. And we have announced 2 years ago that we are going to invest additional £5 million. There are a lot of deals that are ongoing. We have done I'm not quite sure about the number, but we have done a decent percentage from the £5 billion we have announced, and we are looking. Our fund is really looking at the opportunities where it lies. Whenever it comes, it doesn't mean that we have a specific agenda to invest in different regions. It means that we are going to ignore. Europe will always present good opportunities. And the QIA will always be ready to look at these opportunities and validate it if it's a valuable and viable opportunity for our investments. We will go for it.
Sheikh Mohammed, Minister, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Chris. Thank you.